presented by Dano Seasoning. Yum yum, get you some.
Welcome into the Sunbelt Syndicate podcast. I am your host, Dominic Crescetto. Actually, I am now going to be a co-host as we welcome our new co-host who hails from Beaufort, North Carolina, where he played quarterback at East Carteret High School. He led all North Carolina quarterbacks and ranked 10th in the state overall with over 2,000 rushing yards as a senior. That would earn him his scholarship to Appalachian State, where he transitioned to wide receiver, started immediately as a true freshman. That season would end with one of three straight national titles, and most notably, the 2007 opening game victory over the Michigan Wolverines there in Ann Arbor. TJ Courman is now our co-host, pretty much full-time. We'll see if he loves to stay on or not. But TJ, welcome to the show, man.
Yeah, thanks for having me, man. I'm excited to be a part of it. Certainly a dream of mine. I've been talking to a few friends about, starting a podcast, and then you came to me a couple of weeks ago with your idea, and I was like, absolutely, would love to be a part of it. Just offer, some different perspective from a player, side of it. You know, it's one thing to talk about it. It's one thing to know football. It's another thing, too, to have played it and can offer some insight from that perspective. So happy to be here, man. Happy to be joining you.
Yeah, well, thank you for doing it. And just like you said, this is the experience that people want to hear, because I never played I played flag football. So technically,
counts. It's still football.
Yeah. I mean, I still wasn't good, but I tried it. I don't know if I would have been any good at tackle, man. I can't believe how sore I was after playing flag football. Just
right.
I played soccer all growing up. The bends and turns you make there, you're like, oh, yeah, mm-hmm. I could do football. No, it's a totally different beast, and I can only imagine what it feels like to get hit by somebody about twice your size. Luckily, I never had to go through that, but maybe you can tell us a little bit more about how it feels to get popped, when you're coming across the middle as a wide receiver. I'm sure that doesn't feel very good.
No, not at all. I spent most of my life trying to get away from people in other color jerseys. So I did the most I could to not get hit, unless there was a part of the game where, you absolutely had to. But for the most part, for me, it was let's steer clear of those big guys. As hard as that was playing in the slot, you got block receivers and safeties that are all about a foot taller than you and maybe 30 pounds heavier. But
it
comes with the territory.
Well, it looks like, you're out there looking like the wide receiver from Ohio State. Man, I'm going blank on his name. I know you can help me out with this.
Marvin.
Marvin Harrison Jr. There we go.
Yeah, that's who I thought. Yeah, that's what I thought you were talking about.
That dude is jacked. I just saw that picture. I don't know if it was edited a little bit at all, but even if it was, I don't want to be lining up. There might be some defensive players actually scared to tackle him.
Oh, absolutely. I was going to say, there's a couple guys. I mean, A.J. Brown for the Eagles. I, as a Cowboys fan, obviously, I hate the Eagles. However, A.J. Brown is a man. I mean, that dude is – it's just one of a few. I mean, what's the guy out of San Francisco? Debo. I mean, he's
Debo Samuel.
Yeah. I mean, he's a giant. So, I mean, there's a lot of receivers that are – it's not what it used to be. The receiver position is certainly not what it used to be. You've got these guys that can do multiple things now. I mean, I was one of those guys in college who, was able to run the ball as well as, go run routes, run after catch kind of player. So it's certainly the game is changing for sure. It's not just your slender go up and get it wide receivers anymore. That's for sure.
Oh yeah. I think like back when probably you were still playing in college and Megatron mm-hmm. was in the NFL. I mean, that was the first guy I remember being like a totally different mold of a wide receiver. And obviously now, like you just mentioned, and obviously DK Metcalf along with that, these guys just like, I don't know if enough of them watched Megatron back in the day and just like, I want to be like that. I don't want to be some little toothpick wide receiver, even though Randy Moss was great and he wasn't a big dude.
Yeah, right. But so was T.O. I mean,
yeah, that's true. Well, T.O. was – he had some good size to him, too.
Well, but that's what I mean. Like, Randy Moss was great as a skinny guy, and T.O. was just a – what was T.O.? 6'3 and some change, 235, and ran a 4.440? I mean, that's insane. Yeah. That's insane. Yeah.
It's insanity. Absolutely. So, TJ, we've talked about the wide receiver position a little bit. So you were a quarterback in high school, and you were recruited to Appalachian State, as you told me, as a running back. So kind of tell us about how that transitioned into you becoming a wide receiver for App State.
Yeah. So again, like I said, recruited as a running back, came down, you know, went to the spring game, I think in March of, March of 2005, you know, just watching, took a break and come down from high school. And I saw, that's the first time I saw Kevin Richardson up close. Didn't know who the guy was, didn't know anything about him, knew he was a sophomore, and he went absolutely nuts during the spring game. I mean, he just lost his mind. I'd never seen anybody run like that. And I, you know, coming from high school, I was pretty good. At least I thought I was. I saw him running. I was like, you guys sure? You sure you want me to come play running back? You sure you don't have your guy already? And then so left, obviously thinking, you know, I'm going to be his backup. Not a big deal. We go into, I guess you can call it training camp or summer camp for workouts. And he hasn't lost a step. I mean, it's like he's been there the entire time. He gets in, I mean, he's running and just making it look easy. I get in and I'm trying to find my way, still trying to figure out how to be a running back, having played quarterback in high school. And we get into the meeting rooms the next day, and the running back coach, we call him Lomo at the time, comes up to me and he's like, "Hey, you thought about playing slot receiver?" And I said, "No, not really. That's not what you guys recruited me." He's like, you might want to consider it, because it's going to be a long day trying to back up Kevin. And I was like, yeah, I kind of figured as much. So that led to me moving over to the slot. And it was a cool transition, too, because I was not, as a quarterback out of high school, never ran routes before. So it was a nice little segue into me learning how to play receiver while still being able to be a running back, running reverses, kind of being the scat back, you know, kind of deal. So it was cool because it gave me some time to ramp up to being a receiver, you know, running go routes and out routes and little quick stuff over the middle while still being able to motion into the backfield and that kind of thing. So it was a seamless transition. I think I got a lot better as my sophomore and junior year came on. In terms of being able to take a whole summer to learn it. Because you're coming in out of high school, you don't have time. But you're learning playbook, you're learning what you're doing, you know, that kind of thing. And then to
learn how to live on your own.
Right. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Being broke. And so learning that part of it, or having to go through that part of it, certainly helped with, you know, my ramp up time. So, yeah.
Nice. Yeah, I bet the quarterback room loved you because you understood what they wanted you to do to either get open or to make the adjustments on the fly. So I bet that was like a nice little tool to have in your back pocket personally. So that makes a lot of sense, really. And then, you know, obviously someone on the team when you were, Armonte Edwards, did talk pretty much the same type of thing when he went to the NFL. It's probably something that, you know, a lot of guys maybe not think it makes a lot of sense from the outside perspective, but as an insider that you guys literally were, I'm sure it's like, yeah, no, that makes total sense to me. I can see this and that.
Yeah, absolutely.
Meanwhile, we're as fans over here, not understanding any of that aspect, unless you've watched some of that quarterback series on Netflix. Have you checked that out at all?
So, no. And I've heard about, my wife actually brought it up to me a couple of days ago. She was like, "I can't believe you haven't watched it." I was just like, "I hadn't had time. Between work, school, you know, my son, and then I'm cooking, that kind of thing." So it just hadn't had time to watch it, but I will. But there's a lot of knowledge being passed around in that show, from what I understand anyway. I've seen some snippets and that kind of thing, but there's a lot of knowledge being passed around for sure.
Yeah. The most interesting thing to me, we're going to talk about your grilling here in a second, is the fact that my wife showed interest in watching something about football.
Right.
I know, right? It's not often. Most of us struggle to get them involved. But she was the one who's like, "No, we should watch that. I really want to watch that." And I said, "Oh yeah, absolutely." So we rifled through that thing in, it takes, I think, 3 or 4 days to watch the whole series. Which I'm sure there were aspects she didn't like or care for, but I think she thought it was interesting enough. And, you know, they loop in the family for those that haven't watched it. So it's perfect to kind of see it from multiple sides of, obviously, quarterbacks, because they got three different guys they're following around, but They also show a little bit of the family aspect and the background behind why things happened or didn't happen. So it's a really, I love the fact that they shot that. I didn't even know that was being done, obviously, until it really came out. So
Yeah, me either.
Yeah, so I hope they do it again. I know that they're going to struggle to get some people to sign up for that, because once TJ, once you watch it, you're going to realize that, you know, some of the things, like the language was flying for Mahomes. People didn't realize that's how he spoke. Right. I'm like, mm-hmm. You also have to think there's a switch. You know this and can explain this better than I can. There's a switch when you're out there that just goes off. You're not that guy off the field, you know?
100%.
There's guys trying to kill you on the other side of the ball. So you have to be elevated somewhere instead of just being like, oh, you know, I'm going out here to try and score and do the best I can today. Yeah, that's good when you're a kid, but when you're an adult who's doing this for a living as a profession, you better come with it, because somebody else will take you out literally in order to get that done. So TJ, you just touched on it. I want you to expand a little bit. So obviously your playing career is done, I think, for the most part. Maybe, are you still playing a little bit on the side? I know you're coaching your son's team, but.
Right. No. Not doing any playing now. These knees aren't what they used to be. So not doing any playing.
Right. So you've transitioned into another love of yours, which is grilling and I guess cooking overall in general, right?
Yep.
So tell everybody what you do kind of on the side.
Yeah. So I do some cooking. I've catered a few events around the Triangle area. Name of the company is Thick Thighs and Large Fries. So
I love
it. Yeah, we do everything smoked meats. I mean, that's not obviously the only thing we do. But we certainly do a lot of different types of things. I mean, obviously you've got your traditional briskets and your ribs and your whole chickens and that kind of thing. And then it's everything from pasta dishes to desserts, to really anything, sides, macaroni and cheese, really anything that you could think of. I always look at it like this, and maybe I shouldn't simplify it as much as I'm about to. But I feel like if you can read, you can cook. Right. Everything that you're ever going to cook is written down. Somebody has done it before you. There's a blueprint for it. And it's just like football. Right. There's no difference. And that's sort of where the passion comes from, because I can read a playbook and I can understand what needs to happen on the field. Why is that different in the kitchen? And so that's sort of it kind of transitioned and fueled my love for it because of the preparation that goes into it. Right. It's still the same level of preparation. It's still. How am I going to get this out? What kind of product am I going to put out? And do people want it? Do people want to watch me play football? And do people want to eat my food? Right. And so, it's twofold as it relates to that.
That is probably the coolest way anyone's ever explained grilling and cooking to a sport, honestly. Like that, I didn't even see that coming. And the way you transitioned that was awesome. Which makes me feel like a bigger idiot for not really being able to do that. I like to microwave meals and eat fast food. So,
the funny thing is, my wife always tells me, she's like, don't say that to people, because then you're gonna make them feel stupid if they can't cook. Well, I mean, it's not that hard. read a book. What are we doing? No, it seriously is though. Because I mean, and here's the other thing too. I mean, you've got NFL guys that are super talented, but can't understand the playbook, right? They can't retain the knowledge. They can't get it all. They can't put it to memory. And again, the two things are super different. But in terms of preparation, it's the same, right? I can read a cookbook all day long, but if I can't understand and interpret that cookbook and also tailor it to myself, right? Because I know that my taste is a little bit different from your taste per se. Right. And so for me, while the recipe says this, there may be some things I tamper with a little bit. Right. And it's just the same as playing receiver. There might be a dig route or an out route that I have to run that maybe the safety's not giving me the proper leverage that I'm looking for to run that route. So I've got to do some things along the way to sort of maneuver it and make it fit me. Right. And to make that route, my own. So it's the same. I mean, and a lot of things can be equated, from a sports perspective. But that's really how I look at my life overall.
Absolutely. And you have actually used some of the Dano seasoning, as we discussed earlier. Is that correct?
Yeah, absolutely. Love Dano seasoning. Dano's is probably top tier in terms of what I also, I like Malcolm Reed's as well. So I would put them kind of on that same level. You know, nice. I don't know how much you know about Malcolm Reed, How to Barbecue Right. He has a little podcast that he does as well. But as far as Dano's goes, I mean, they're neck and neck with their seasoning. And I love Dano's chicken seasoning. His all purpose seasoning. Certainly a lot of the, you know, and I also like the fact that Dano's has some salt free options as well. For people who are trying to, you know, yeah, people like me who are trying to watch your weight, you know, the salt free seasonings are certainly something to look into.
Nice. Well, let's check out this awesomely creepy ad from Dano's right now.
We'll get back. I do love it.
Right after that. Yum yum, get you some. Yum yum, get you some.
Seasoning, food's favorite flavor.
Yum yum, get you some.
I'm Joe Burrito, your favorite burrito. Whoa.
Joe, hey. We all know you're the best.
What?
You can always do better. Try the new Dano's hot chipotle.
Hey. Ooh, that's spicy. Yum yum.
Yum yum, get you some.
I love it. You gotta love that commercial.
Not creepy at all, right? Not, you know, faces on dancing chickens, not creepy at all. But
no, and the burrito, the voice of the burrito is just like so weird and creepy too. And then he's just getting topped with seasoning and about to be eaten, which is disappointing because I just had a burrito last night and I don't have any Dano's at the house, unfortunately. So I got to get on that and make it my mission to actually consume some of these Dano's seasonings. But I do hear they also have this new cheesy flavor. So I'm definitely trying that on some fries because it sounds
like here's an idea. Cheesy flavor on some popcorn. That might do it. Ooh. That might be the ticket.
That might be even better.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, it's,
you're talking to a guy who loves food here.
So. Yeah. Well, it's obvious that with what you do on the side, you've got to love the flavors that you have to try out. So it makes
sense.
And it makes sense why Dano's is a sponsor of football, tailgate food. It's just all looping together. It's perfect. It's a perfect fit, really.
Yeah, it works for sure.
So let's touch on kind of how you rolled through your career, really. I mean, I don't know how much you want to get into like real specifics, but I mean, you started playing immediately as a freshman, and then you guys go on to win three straight titles. I mean, maybe on the team in one aspect and like just the program and the town itself, like, did you see some massive sweeping change while you were there? Or, you know, maybe just explain to people how App kind of transitioned from this team that could kind of come close a couple times and never really get it done to the team that was just expected to win it every time.
No. And it's funny that you bring it up because when I got there my freshman year, it wasn't expected of us, obviously. Right. It was, you know, I think they had just come off like a 5 or 6 win season, you know, and it wasn't one of those things where championship level was expected from us. And for me, it was just go in and try to find some success, try to find a way to play, get on the field, you know, really, like I said, get on the field altogether. But let alone, you know, be a main contributor to us winning some national championships and being as successful as we were. So, you know, I got the opportunity to play with Richie Williams. Obviously, Armani Edwards, who you see here, was just an absolute dog. Played with a lot of guys that were that way. And, it was from a talent perspective. I mean, as you can see, I mean, look at Coco Hillary here. I mean, we had talent all over the field, right? It was so hard to match up with us from a spread offense perspective because we were just fast at every position, first of all, and there was so much misdirection and our passing game was so sophisticated for that time. I think we were ahead of where the rest of the college football was going, right? You know, college football at the time was headed there, but they hadn't got there yet to that sophistication of a passing game. And I think that it took somebody special like Richie Williams, somebody like Armani Edwards to come in to have that kind of talent to be able to do that because, we ran some complicated routes. And while the route tree is not complicated, the route combinations were. And so that led to a lot of our success, man, was just being able to manipulate defenses. We had a bunch of smart guys, too. On our offense, right? Who understood coverage, understood leverage, how to run routes, what it looked like from a defensive perspective. I mean, there's my old roommate right here, Devin Moore. He's one of the ones that understood pass protection. And it helps to have a guy that can do that, right? That can run guys over and get you 30 yards a clip, you know, when the offense is spread out. So, it was outstanding. I mean, I'd go back. I tell my wife all the time, I'd go back and do everything the same if I had the opportunity.
Nice. Well, I mean, it's hard to say otherwise when you won three straight titles. I mean, at that point, no one had done it. So, I specifically grabbed this Delaware clip because Hunter, who helps run College Football Dogs here, wanted me to talk to you about this game since he was there. He was a Delaware fan, and he wanted to know if the name Paul Warlow is familiar to you. Did you line up across the field from him or remember him at all in this game?
I do not remember a Paul Warlow.
Okay.
I assume he was safety or corner.
I think he was actually a linebacker, which would make sense about why you probably don't remember him off the top of your head,
right. But yeah.
Apparently he was one of their guys there, but you know, they weren't stopping you guys much this night. So I was there too for this one. What a night that was. I mean, literally a home game, right? I mean, did it sound like a home game that day?
Yeah, it was. I mean, it felt like we were in the backyard. I mean, it was, and at that point, Chattanooga had become a second home for us. Like it was, you know, first of all, it's not that far from App State. And then secondarily, I mean, we'd played there, you know, both in season and then for championships so often. And I say that sounds so arrogant. I don't mean it that way. But we played there so often that it was just like, you know, it was expected for us to be there. I mean, there were times that we played UT Chat in that stadium and we had more fans there than they did. Just because, you know, of how we traveled. And that's another thing, too, about App. They travel. You guys we travel really, really well. I know you were a fan back when I was playing, and you guys, I mean, y'all showed up, and you were loud, and you were proud, and sometimes it rubbed some people the wrong way from a celebration perspective. I remember, I think it was actually the Delaware game, the national championship for Delaware, where we got kind of, I want to say chastised on ESPN about how our fans were coming out of the stands like a minute or two before the game was up. I was like, what do you want them to do? You know, this is what they came here for.
Yeah, they're filling out. The party started well before that game really even started. Because like we just said, it was an expectation there. Like, we don't show up here to not win. Like, we're coming home with the trophy. I don't care about Joe Flacco being an NFL quarterback in the future.
Right.
He ain't getting it done tonight. That game was close for, like a quarter? I mean,
it was a blowout.
Yeah. And it was all we heard from the Delaware fans is all their NFL talent and all these guys with size. It's like, did you not learn anything from the Michigan game where it's not all about size and strength? It's also about speed and quickness. And I guess that's a perfect lead-in to start checking out the highlights from that game, TJ. What can you share with us in this one particularly? You know, you're coming off a championship. You're coming into a place where they're expected to win a championship at the level that's just one higher. I mean, I know, you know, I've read the book, what you guys did in off season to prepare for this. Pretty much everything was pushed to focus on this team, get this victory, worry about week two when it comes, right? Which was LR, who you also smashed. But in this game, just tell us a little bit about the experience of being on the field for an upset as big as that.
Yeah, no, that was outstanding, obviously. I mean, next to the national championships, that's probably, you know, right up there, 1-1 and 1A, I would say. But yeah, no, I mean, going back, even in start of winter gym that February, you know, prior to the season, everything was that, I mean, we had a singular focus, and that was Michigan. That focus was, you know, they're going to be bigger than us. They're going to be stronger than us. Obviously, people are going to you know, not give us a chance coming into the game. But we knew, looking at their roster, we knew a few things. Number one, they were not faster than we were by no stretch of the imagination. As a matter of fact, I don't think from a defensive perspective, they matched up with us very well. If you take a look at just our overall team speed, they didn't match up with us very well in that.
I want to jump in there real quick because I absolutely agree with that. Before you continue, as an outside fan, I don't think enough people watch the actual game, right? You see it, they see the highlights. I'm telling you right now, they played that game 100 times. You're winning it more times than not. Because I totally agree with what you said. It wasn't just luck. It wasn't just Michigan playing bad. There was a difference in skill level and speed out there. Yes. I mean, sure, they had talent, and that's why they almost came back, right? There was a chance. That's how good those guys were in a game where you really dominated up until the half. I mean, they still had a shot because that's how good they were. But the speed and the elusiveness was just another. People were shocked in the stands sitting beside me. So sorry to interrupt, but I want to just tell everyone I absolutely agree with what you're saying. And it wasn't just because you were on the field, even from an outside perspective. That game shouldn't even have been as close as it was, really, right? I mean, we made some mistakes.
I was just ready to say that. Yeah, we made multiple mistakes. I know Imani threw an interception in my direction. That was my fault. I ran the wrong route. It was a stars play. I had a back. Normally on stars, I have a backside corner route. But the way that they were playing, their safeties split the field, right? And they immediately evacuated the middle of the field. So we changed the route to an in route for me. And just during the throws of the game, I completely forgot. And it was just, one of those adjustments that we made, I think at halftime or maybe the beginning of the game. I can't remember exactly when we made that adjustment. And I forgot and was supposed to run an in route. And anyway, long story. So I say that to say, from a mistake perspective, this game should not have been as close as it was. It sounds arrogant to say, and I hate to say it that way, but if we played them 9 more times, we'd probably win 8 more times. Just because, I mean, we were just better. I mean, it's just what it was. We were faster than they were. Again, I go back to, I know I said it earlier, I spoke to how sophisticated our passing game was. We had a very sophisticated passing game. It was not your lineup, you're running slants and you're running goes and out routes. And that was not it. You know, our passing, our offensive pass game was far ahead of its time. And I don't think that they took that into account when they decided they were going to play us.
There was a play you were talking about just there.
Yeah, so they showed it.
Don't worry for everyone out there that doesn't know. TJ redeemed himself later in the game with a huge pickup. Was it third down? I can't remember off the top of my head. I think it was
second or third and 11. I can't remember. But I was supposed to get 5 yards and get out of bounds. And I just felt this. Well, two things. So two things motivated me on that play. And I'm actually glad you brought it up. First thing is, I always rely on my quickness and my ability to make people miss. And, I took pride in not the first person not being able to tackle me. That's one thing. The second thing was the way that line or that safety, number 22, he actually went to high school, I think, at Butler with Leonard Love, in Charlotte. But the way he was coming downhill, had I run that ball right out of bounds, he would have gotten to me, first of all, before I got out of bounds.
Yeah,
he would have probably knocked the snot out of me if I had run that the way I was supposed. I was not about to get hit like that. And you weren't going to put me on a highlight. That's not going to happen. I'm not letting that happen. So for me, it was, just instinctual, not wanting to get tackled as far as, making a man miss. But part of it, too, was I can't let myself get – I mean, it blasted into their sideline would have been just – yeah, I don't want to deal with that. I was highly motivated on that play.
we talked about this play because I told you I was sitting there in the stands, yelling, "Get out of bounds! Get out of bounds!" Right. And then you pull that famous split second stop and kind of that like push him out of your way and then keep going. Oh man, it was genius because nobody saw it coming. Certainly, which is funny because then you tell me after that when we had this conversation before. I don't know if you remember that conversation specifically, but when we had that conversation before, you told me that was your go-to move. And then when I've seen a couple other highlights, I noticed you aren't lying. I saw you pull it a couple more times and it worked every time.
Yeah. And it's so weird because you have to know what's coming. Like you're running full speed at a guy who's shifty. Like I'm small. Like that's I'm 5'8". I'm not, you got to know that I'm not about to run head up with you. Like this is not, that's not my game. And I just use their momentum against you. I mean, you can run as fast as you can in one direction, but how quickly can you turn? How quickly can you get out of that cut? And so for me, it was always a go-to. That and the spin move. Those are my two moves.
Yeah. And they worked. I mean, I remember the spin move too. But the one that sticks with me is obviously the one against Michigan where you're on the biggest stage and you don't. The coolest part is that you don't cower from trying it, right? Because in that moment, you can raise up. Yep, this is it. Whoop! I mean, that guy, talk about losing your shoes. That guy was out of them. He tried to stop in reverse. I don't know what he thought he was going to be able to do there, but that was.
Yeah, well, like I said, he was running so fast, full speed, like his aim was to knock me out. I knew I could feel it. Right. And I was like, I'm not letting him hit me like this. This is crazy.
It was a smart move. It worked out for you and the team overall. And it went on, and obviously, what some people perceive as the biggest upset in sports history, certainly what I think is the biggest upset in college football history. Being a hockey fan, it's hard for me to say that the miracle on the ice might not be a little bigger.
That's
and the
fair. Only reason I say fair that. Point. No, fair. That's fair.
Well, we talked about this, though, because I think that you would beat them more often than not, right? So to me, and the reason the miracle on ice is bigger is because they literally played them a few days before and they got trounced. The Russian team crushed the Americans. Well, I don't even remember what the score was. I think it was like double digits to like.
I was going to say it was a lot to a little. That's for sure.
Yeah, so there was proof in the pudding that they should not have even been in a game like that. And then they win it. I've had people disagree with me on this, but that's why I don't think that it's the best upset of all time in a good way towards all of you that were on the field. Because I think it was that much of a great game for you guys, both in schematics and the play on the actual field. So, hopefully you don't take offense to that. But
you go ask any of our players, and they'll all tell you the same thing. There was no way they were going to beat us that day. There was just no way. I mean, we were just, again, in every facet of the game, from a skill perspective, we were better than them. Everywhere on the field, we were better. I mean, they had some obviously name brand players. You got Chad Henne.
Right.
I think it was Manningham. They had Mario Manningham at the time.
Yep. He made that catch that almost put them in.
Yeah.
Well, it put him in scoring position. They just didn't do it.
And then, and then Corey Lynch happened. Mike Hart.
Yeah, Mike. Oh, man. And you know what? You talked about the offense. Defensively, you guys disrupted the hell out of them, too, because Mike Hart got injured. Not that it's just happenstance. He got hit so hard. It was his thigh, I think, that someone gave him like a
helmet. Thigh or upper, thigh or somewhere upper leg, yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, it wasn't a dirty play at all. It was just a hard-nosed tackle.
Mm-hmm.
And again, you know, as an upper echelon player like he was, I don't know if he expected them not to hit hard or what. But, you guys brought it on every side of the ball. I do remember Pierre Banks quoted, I think it was in that ESPN clip, though, when he sacks Henne, talking about like how'd you feel when you hit him, and I think Pierre said something along the lines of that it hurt. Like that guy was huge, and it didn't want to go down easy. It was still a massive hit, but Pierre gets up, throws up, with the fraternity.
Omega Psi Phi. His horns.
There you go. I would have never gotten that right, but I knew it was from. I just
we'll give you a pass. You didn't really live the frat life, so we'll give you a pass.
No, I didn't even live the college life. Well, I mean, I lived the college life. I didn't even attend App State. I don't know if you even know that. I went to the community college down the road. So
I did. I think you did tell me that. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, so I mean, I live with App State students, and I live like across campus. So I did all the stuff that App fans or App students got to do. So I felt like I lived it a little bit indirect, if it is at that. So thanks for taking us through that. I mean, that's awesome. It's always fun to hear how that goes, and I'm glad you had such a successful career. It's awesome to hear that type of story and how you went through it. And I'm sure from time to time there'll be other things you remember that. You could share with us as well. But let's be honest, this podcast specifically is about the Sun Belt. And let's just take a look maybe about what you think overall. Obviously, you played in the SoCon, which obviously is not the same as two of those teams do jump into the now Sun Belt. So maybe we can just take a look at well, I'll pull the map up here while we're talking and just talk about, as a player and maybe as a fan, like what's the benefit to this compared to some of these other teams and programs that are now traveling across the country? I mean, the regionality of it, the teams, the fact that some of them truly hate each other. You know, I know you weren't there for the Marshall rivalry, but I'm sure you knew about it and it was storied. And then you were obviously there for the Georgia Southern rivalry. So if you want to share any aspects of that one as we go through this, I'll obviously welcome that as well.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think I guess I'll start with your first question. The benefit of having a conference close together like this is, you know, travel time. Right. I mean, we talked about it, you know, before we went on air. It's so difficult traveling out of different time zones and boarding a plane and sleep patterns and all those things. I mean, number one, just sleeping in your own bed alone is one thing. But then you're talking about, you know, right now, I think there's a couple teams that's out of the Pac-12 that are going to enter the Big Ten. And I mean, you're going now from, you know, let's take Michigan, for example, going all the way down to, you know, USC or wherever. I mean, that's a lot, right? That's a lot on students that are not getting paid to play, which, you know, NIL is one thing. We'll talk about that too as we go along. But I think that the benefit of what the Sun Belt Conference offers us is the regionality aspect. And that is, you know, you're going to get high performers. I would say, I'd venture to say every week, right? You're going to get a high performance game every week because we're not having to try. I mean, you know, you take App State going to Georgia Southern. I mean, even going there when I was at App, 6-hour bus ride down to Savannah, right? You know, still travel, but not as bad. So, I think from a regional perspective, I think I like what it does because it gives us quality football every week from our perspective. So, yeah, I mean, you know, and then there's some built in rivalries as well. I mean, obviously us and Georgia Southern. God, I mean, I can't tell you how much I hate Georgia Southern. I can't even put it into words.
Yeah, the interesting aspect is that, you know, App typically recruits Georgia pretty well. So, like, how many guys per season, or I mean, I don't need you to put a number on it, but I mean, how many, like, kind of knew each other or played against each other with each other? Is there a lot of familiarity across the field? Is that part of the reason for some of the heatedness of that rivalry?
Yeah. We had a lot of guys that started for us, both offense and defense, that were from Georgia, that Atlanta area. Obviously not a lot in South Georgia. We had some guys from Macon, you know, that was on our team. I know Jock was from St. Mary's, which is right on that Florida Georgia line. So he was very familiar with, you know, Georgia Southern. But it was just, I think more so than anything else was, they had the history, right? They've got championships and they've got all the things that we wanted, and they kept rubbing it in our face so much. And then when we started winning, it was, well, you guys, you know, you got one, you'll still never be on our level. And then we won again. Yeah. Well, you know, and it's like, okay, you know what? I'm really starting to hate you. Like, stop doing this. Like, just give us our credit, you know, and they would never give us our credit, even though, like, theirs were one in the 90s. And this is terrible coming from a Cowboys fan. Their championships were one in the 90s. It's like, stop living in the past. You know, this is happening right now. And right now you're not better than us. And so it just turned into, I mean, it happened so organically for us that it was one of those things where you almost overlook the game before it and the game after, because you put so much energy and focus into, you know, because Georgia Southern is hate week. I mean, and that's just, let's just call it what it is. I mean, it's legitimate hate week. And you know, it's again, it's not a Ohio State, Michigan. It's not a Cowboys, Redskins, or I guess now they're Commanders. So let me be politically correct. Cowboys, Commanders. You know,
how dare Carolina, you, Duke. How dare you?
I know, right? It's not a Carolina, Duke. You know, it's not that. But for what it is that. You know, for us, it is that. It's you know, our rival, and we love to hate them, and they love to hate us. And I live for it. Even now, you know, and I'm 36 years old, you know, however many years removed from college football, when it's Georgia Southern week, nothing else, nothing else matters. You know, my wife knows. I turn the TV on the back deck and just leave me alone. Let me do this. So, yeah, I do love the conference now. I love that JMU came. I love, again, that Georgia Southern came. I love that Coastal's in it. I also hate Coastal. That's another hate week that I'm starting to kind of grow into, even though we played them and it wasn't really a game. And since they've gotten better, they talk so much now. It's like, come on, man. Like,
I was gonna mention that, because I know we tried to meet up last year at the Coastal game for app, and somehow TJ, of course, finds himself on the sideline, the best seat in the house. But yeah, I was gonna actually ask you your thoughts and feelings on that, since that one has just like sprung out of nowhere. But it's interesting to now already hear you say the hatred's there, even though you didn't really play them at that level. Like you said, you did play them literally. I think, was that a first round playoff game that you guys had?
No, for us, we played them regular season, I think my sophomore or junior year. I can't remember exactly what year. I mean, it was like 30-0 at halftime. Like, it wasn't even it wasn't a game. And they really wanted to play us kind of to get the exposure, and because they were up and coming at the time. And, you know, but to their credit, I mean, they've done some major recruiting, and, you know, they are a really good football team at this point in, you know, this stage. And here's the other thing too, it's almost like cheating. Cause like, who wouldn't want to go to school? Like, I can almost say with 100% certainty that if, you know, if they had recruited me out of high school, I probably would have went to Coastal. I mean, it's, you know, 3.5 hours away from home. It's still on the beach, warm weather all the time. I mean, who wouldn't want to go play at, you know, it's like asking if you want to go play in Miami. Yeah, absolutely. I would love to. Yeah. Which is another thing. I don't know why Miami's not good. But that's another conversation for another day. But yeah, I don't know why anybody wouldn't want to play on the beach. So it's kind of a cheat code, to be quite honest.
Yeah. No, you're not lying.
But to their credit, I mean, like I said, they've gotten a lot better. I think they're going to continue to get better. They're going to continue to be a thorn in our side, which is great. It's great for football, great for the conference. Yep. I think between us, Georgia Southern, Coastal, and JMU, and then every now and again Marshall and the Raging Cajuns, they're really good.
Now, I mean, have you been down there?
I have not, and that's a bucket list thing. I do want to go to South Louisiana. I want to watch them play. And I want to watch at Louisiana game, but I have not been yet.
Yeah, I can tell you I've been lucky to be down there twice. Okay. And none of them were for the – well, I guess I only played a championship game there once. But mm-hmm. both of them were just regular season, you know, Wednesdays and Thursday nights. It just worked out that I could loop it in with a business trip and make it all make sense. But – I'm telling you what, man, you're going to be in heaven when you get down there with the food, man. Just amazing. And the people are awesome. You know what it sounds like to me? Because I never got to go to Montana. Were you one of the guys
I was graduated a year before they went to Montana.
Okay. So, but from the fans' perspective, Louisiana, Lafayette in general, sounds a lot like Missoula and Montana. Like, you hate each other on the field, but like the fans are awesome to each other before the game, and they're very inviting. I'm sure, you know, other people in the other side of the conference in the West Division do not agree with that assessment. But with us being up here further in the East Coast in a very different atmosphere and culture that we live in, to go down there and experience that, I will go back. Excuse me. I will go back there anytime I can. Absolutely fantastic. I think that's kind of like the Miami thing for me. I mean, obviously it's not the same level, but like the fact that the Cajun fans don't fill up that stadium is surprising to me. It's not a slight
insane
on them, because, you know, they're good people and they obviously have Baton Rouge like an hour away. You know, there's a little bit of that aspect at play there, but I mean, they deserve it, man. The talent on the field is obviously there. I think they get a little bit better this year too, but it's just a great place to go see a game because of everything you experience, you know, leading up to and even after after we got beat the last time I was there, we went back out to the bar. We're there till like 2 a.m. because people didn't want us to leave. They wanted to talk and hang out. It was just
So to your point, so I played against LSU my freshman year and my senior year. And to your point about them being just tremendous people, they're great people on and off the field. I mean, you know, we played against, so my freshman year, they had LeRon Landry. They had, Jamarcus Russell, Trendon Holiday. I mean, they had, some guys. And, during the game, first of all, they knew they were going to beat us. And to be quite honest, we knew it too. You know, it wasn't a Michigan thing. We were just not ready. We were not who we were when we played Michigan, when going down to LSU. And, but to the point of them being nice people, even on the field, they're like, what are you guys doing after the game? What are you guys doing? And we're focusing on the game. We're like, they know that they're going to win. So it's easy to have these conversations for us. It's like, let us focus on getting the hell beat out of us first. And then then we'll talk about it. But then, they were just like, what are you guys doing after the game? Y'all want to hang out? There's a party here. If y'all are staying, come hang out with us and do this and blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, wow. For guys that are kicking our ass right now, you guys are really nice.
Yeah, that is weird. Yeah, because you hear the opposite of that a lot. The trash talking that happens on the field and the disrespect and all that. So yeah, it is interesting to hear that sometimes it is the exact opposite of that, and they're just like, I like this guy. He's cool. What's going on?
Yeah, they're just generally. Not, it's funny because the corner that I was going against, I forget his name at the time. I was lined up across from him. And he was about, I ran a modest, 4.45-ish. I was in that ballpark. Not terribly fast, just not slow either. And this guy was like 6'1", 6'2". He was like 205. And he was like stride for stride with me. And I'm, he's just like running easily stride for stride with me. And I'm like, how do you guys get this big and also this fast at the same time? It's, it's homegrown for sure. Accents absolutely. Are so fun to anyway. I can go talking to those guys playing down there, I could see why, And from that day forward, actually, I became an LSU fan, and I to this day am diehard LSU. As far as outside of App State, LSU's my team. I go
That makes a little sense because now I know a story behind it. Because I always kind of wondered how you attach to LSU. I see you share stuff or talk about their games. So that makes a whole lot more. I thought maybe it was like a cowboy that had come from LSU. Maybe that started you into that fandom. That makes sense. Now, I'll tell you, I'm the opposite. Not necessarily for like one specific instance, but when I went down there in your senior year, that game was miserable for a multitude of reasons. But the biggest reason being that they kept moving the damn game. It was supposed to be a night game in Death Valley. It was going to be the best atmosphere. You're coming off FCS championship. They're coming off an FBS championship. This is going to be some big Goliath versus Goliath. Not really, but, essentially champion versus champion. It's the first time it ever happened. I got tickets way ahead of time. I drove all the way down from Boone. I was ready to experience this. We get about halfway there. My buddy's texting me saying, hey, they moved the game up to noon. And then I'm like, no way they did that. It's heat of the day. Well, the hurricane was coming. Then by the time we got all the way there, they moved it up to 10 a.m. local time.
10 a.m., yeah.
So I will tell you that I was tailgating with six tall boys in the parking lot right next to our Monty Edwards family.
That's awesome.
I'm pretty sure his like cousin or somebody was throwing the football better than I was, and he was like 5 years old. So it was an awesome time to start the day, but that was probably about the extent of the fun after that. I think I got tiger bait yelled in my face by about everybody I walked by trying to get to the stadium. It was hotter than hell. I don't think I've ever been more miserably hot in my life, and the only thing that helped was that I did have some booze in the system. I stole the washcloth from the hand towel from the hotel and had it over top of my head to, somehow diminish some of the sunlight that was just blasting my entire body throughout standing there for that game.
It's hot, man. But, it was so hot.
Yes. So jumping back into this map real quick before we move on to kind of your thoughts on NIL collectives and all that kind of stuff with players these days, is there anybody you want to see added to the Sun Belt, or you think will be, or maybe like an outside shot at like an FCS team that you really think's got quality enough program to kind of do what James Madison, Georgia Southern, and obviously App State and Coastal have done with moving up from that realm?
You know, as I'm kind of looking at the landscape right now, I don't know that I see anybody that's ready right away. I do think, you know, there was a time where Elon was having a bit of success that you might think, you know, man, they're on the way up. Apart from that, I don't see anybody right now from a landscape perspective, you know, and this is just the extent of what I know from teams that I've played in and from following, I guess, at the time was FCS. And right now I don't see anybody that's on Georgia Southern's, JMU's, App State's, Coastal's level right now.
Yeah, I agree with you on that. I think those teams are all either now up here or they exist, but elsewhere in the country where it wouldn't make sense for the Sun Belt, right? Like,
you've got
North Dakota State. That makes.
I was just getting to say North Dakota. Yep, North Dakota. But again, that wouldn't make sense for them to be in the Sun Belt, right? You know, teams like that, absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, thanks for talking that part over. And now we're going to get to a real interesting aspect, because this is something that didn't exist when you were playing the game. But I know you have thoughts and feelings on this. I know that most of them are probably going to be positive, and they should be. What are your thoughts, and what do you think is going to maybe come out of NILs and collectives that's maybe good and bad? And, I mean, maybe you can look at it as both a former athlete who did it at this level and also a fan now, and you can see where some of these things may not be great or some of them may be really beneficial. Kind of expand on your thoughts on all that.
Yeah, I think NIL is going to be good once we can get a good handle on how things are going to go, right? I think right now we're just kind of shooting at the hip. Whatever university has the largest purse, that's where kids are going to go. I get it. And all of them have big purses, especially down here in the South, right? Like, we love football. And then on the West Coast, you know, we just take it serious. It's a different brand.
Right.
That said, overall, I'm certainly for players getting paid for their name, image, and likeness. It's the most American thing possible, right? Like, you know, you equate it to, once you're 18 years old, you're an adult, right? You can go get a corporate job, whatever. You can do whatever. And if somebody uses your information without your consent, now, again, you're an athlete, you're giving consent, you play for a university, all those things. However, you know, going back to that, you know, you can sue them for using your information if you're not, you know, a part of an organization. So for me, I think using a player, and, you know, I'll use Armani Edwards for an example.
Yeah.
But if we had NIL back then, you know how much money Armani Edwards would have made? Kevin Richardson, Corey Lynch, you know, Pierre Banks, Jock Roman, those guys. I mean, because they were the jerseys that you saw walking around campus, you know, or, you know, at the game, people coming in. So I think overall, name, image, and likeness is certainly something athletes should get paid for. Do I think you should get paid to go to school? No, I don't. And the reason I don't is because, number one, obviously you're getting some call it a free education. It's not free. Waking up at 5 a.m., it's not free. You don't have time to have a job. You don't have time to do college things that other college kids get to do.
Well, it is a job, so, right? I mean, essentially, that, like you said, that's what people do when they have jobs. They get up early and do things they don't necessarily want to do, but they have to for their job. That's what football is to a college athlete who is – well, it's not just football. Any college athlete who's putting in all that extra time and preparation, to me, that is a job. So I totally agree. You should absolutely get paid for your time and effort, because you can't go out and obtain something extra, because that's a third thing you've got to now do. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, and if you think about it, if you're a college football player, college football starts in February. You know, it starts in February and it goes all the way through December and, you know, January if you're Big Ten, SEC, those kinds of things. Like, you get small breaks along the way, right? Like, you get after the season, you get your break until February and winter gym workouts and things like that start. And then from there, you got your spring game in March and April. And then you have a little break between summer workouts in June and July. And then August, this will go all the way until January again. You know, so there's almost no time at all, ever, to have a job, to have a, to be a real student, right? You don't get that real student life. And I say all that to say, you can't have, you know, somebody making, you know, your jersey selling in, I don't know, the mall for $50 and you don't see any of it. And it all goes to the university. And, you know, I always say, and I took a line from Shannon Sharp, where they say, you know, fair is the place where they judge pigs. I don't think that NIL deals should be fair. I think they should be, I think you should get paid appropriately for what you do and your impact. But I don't think everybody, because there was this one conversation that was happening about, you know, well, how do we spread the money out? How do we make sure everybody gets what they deserve? You get what you deserve, but by what you do on the field, you know, and the impact that you have.
Yeah, I do agree with you on that. So now we'll transition from the NIL to the collectives that are trying to do some of that, right? Like what specifically with App beating Texas A&M last year, Texas A&M was known for having a collective that was going to pay essentially just a check to each lineman for, I guess it was like an equal value. Did you feel kind of the same way in those situations, or do you kind of feel like that's like a cheap way to, yes, kind of put a check mark by NIL, these guys are getting paid and that's good, but at the same time, like you're essentially just kind of buying free agents instead of putting together a team as you were a part of, where it was a lot of coordination from your recruiting team and the coaches and the staff to put that kind of thing together?
So again, it's one of those things where it's twofold, right? And I talked about it a bit earlier. There's some kinks that's got to be worked out. You know, we have to come up with a way that it makes sense for everybody. Now, again, it's never going to be quote unquote fair because everybody's not going to have the same impact on the game. Where, you know, there's a collective for offensive linemen. I think that is, you know, it makes sense. Offensive linemen jerseys are not going to sell. They're just not, you know, and they do the bulk of the dirty work, but they're not going to sell like a defensive end jersey would, or defensive tackle or linebacker or receiver, you know, somebody like that. That's just the reality and the nature of the game that we play. That doesn't make them any less important. So having a sort of bucket, I guess you would call it, for them makes sense. But if I'm, you know, I don't know, you're starting wide receiver, you know, and I'm getting all the glory. I don't know that my backup or that person that's not playing deserves just as much as I do. And they haven't done the amount of work, or their name, image, and likeness is not being used as often. You know, and I say that as respectfully as possible because everybody does the same amount of work. We all work hard, all of us. Right. You know, you're at training camps, you're working out, it's hot. You know, you're sweating, everybody, whether you're scout team all the way up to, you know, the number one player on a team, we're all doing the same amount of work. It's just, some people are just more gifted than others. And that's not, it's not a slight to anybody. It's life. That's the way it is. You know, everybody can't be LeBron James. You know, I know I saw a quote other day, I think it was yesterday or maybe it was earlier today. Inez Kanter said that I could have the same career as LeBron if I wanted to, be just an athlete. And I was like, well, maybe, no, you couldn't, because everybody's not equally talented. You know, everybody, that's just not how it goes. Everybody can't be, you know, Steve Jobs, right? You know, so everybody can't be Arthur Blank. You know, there's people who are in places that do things because it was their gift to do. And, you know, not everybody's going to reap that kind of benefit. So it is what it is.
Yeah, no, I agree with that. I do agree with you that there should be some type of, and I don't think either of us know, unfortunately, but like there's got to be some type of stipulation to make it not like total free for all. Like, I don't want college football to become the NFL.
We got to work that part out. Yeah.
Yeah. But I do agree. I love the fact that athletes are getting paid. It's unfortunate. Although I will say, because you kind of touched on it too, let's say NIL existed after you guys beat Michigan. Let's agree that Armonte probably would not have been quarterback much longer at App State, right? I mean,
we'd have lost him. We'd have lost him. Yeah. So there's that part, right? There's that. Right. I mean, it's sort of, I mean, half of, what is it? Half of Colorado, half of Deion Sanders' team are transfers, you know? So there's that part, right? Because they know the NIL deals are going to, I think both of his sons now have like six figure NIL deals, soon to be seven figure NIL, which again, congrats to them. Kudos to them. Yeah. What's the young lady at LSU, basketball player? They just won a national championship last year. Reese.
Yes.
Angel Reese.
Angel Reese.
Yeah. Yes. She just got a deal with Fenty, and with a couple other, a couple other NIL, and deservedly so. Right.
Oh, absolutely.
It's going to happen. But like you said, we've got to figure out a way that it's not just these universities throwing money at these kids and saying, hey, come play for us. And I think there needs to be some agents involved. There needs to be some education involved around that. But I think eventually we'll get to that, to that stage. But for what it's worth, absolutely, these kids should get paid for their work. You know, 100% unequivocally.
Yeah, 100% agree with you on that. I think this is going to pretty much wrap it up. But I'm looking forward to continuing to do this, TJ. I hope you had a good time on this first episode, and we'll add that co-host title underneath your name for the next one. So we can be ready for you on that.
yeah, I didn't know what to put. It asked me what my title was, and I was like, I don't know. I don't know what my – but certainly not a guest at this point.
Grill master. Grill master.
Yeah, no, we can certainly use that. But, no, it's been great. I feel like I talked a lot about myself today, which I don't know if that's good or bad. I feel like people, they already know you, probably need to get to know me a little bit more. But
I don't have a great playing career I can bank on. So that was awesome because I think people do want to know that, right? I mean, you come on here and talk football, I can do it. And people are like, yeah, what does this guy know? Well, when you come on here and talk football, now they know. They've seen clips of you playing the game. They've heard you talk about your experiences. It's going to be just another level. And just to let everybody else know as well with the video aspect, if you're listening to us on the audio only, we'd appreciate it. Hopefully you're enjoying that. But we also have this video aspect throughout the season here. We're going to have some clips that we bring up and help have TJ kind of dissect what he's seen in a play, maybe why a play went for a lot of yards, didn't go for many yards. So we're going to add a different aspect that hopefully you're getting with some of your other podcasts, because we've got the video aspect and we've got an expert who watches a ton of football, and he's going to take a little uptick to what he's watching with the Sun Belt. Obviously he's watching a lot of App State and some other teams, but we're going to evolve him. As much as he wants to be involved and really have fun with this, we thank everyone for following along, listening. Sunbelt Syndicate exists on all social platforms at Sunbelt Syndicate, spacing between each word. At Twitter is all smashed together and it doesn't have the E, so it's Syndicat instead of Syndicate. We'll be posting some clips from shows, some graphics, some interactive stuff to have a little more fun this year. You won't just be hearing my boring voice on a podcast for 20 minutes anymore. And now that we've looped in TJ, we're going to have a lot more fun this year. TJ, any last thoughts before we wrap it up here?
Yeah, no, I mean, I'm excited, echoing everything that you said. Super pumped to be here. Happy to be talking football. Like I said, it's something my wife and I have discussed a long time ago. She's always asked me, why don't you start a podcast? Why don't you do this? And I'm like, well, the good news is I don't have to do the work. Somebody else has already done it. So I could just kind of jump in and be a part of it. So, no, I'm excited about it. Excited to where this can go. And certainly happy to be talking football and give myself a reason to watch more of it. So there's that. Yeah.
Absolutely. So week zero, Sunbelt doesn't have any teams going. TJ and I are going to work towards week one, where Georgia State starts on Thursday night. We'll put something together, and you guys will be able to check it out before Sunbelt play gets started. So until next time, see you guys later.
Sunbelt Syndicate.